This is Point Blank on Eyewitness News. My name is Umaru Sanda Amadu. Tonight on Point Blank, after so much talk, the ambulances have finally been dispatched. 307, or at least that's what we were told. I have not followed them. They've been in the country since September, at least some of them. And today at a ceremony at the Black Star Square in Accra, President Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo officially commissioned them and they have been dispatched. But what happens after the dispatch? That's a conversation I'm going to have tonight with my guest, who is the CEO of the National Ambulance Service, Professor Nuhu Ahmed Zakariah. Prof, you're welcome to Point Blank.
Thank you, sir, Mr. Sander.
What was your own assessment of today's ceremony?
The program went well, and obviously, if you were there, you'll see that everything went well according to what was planned. Mm. Exactly. Mm. So we were really very impressed and very happy.
For you at the ambulance service, this is a huge input, isn't it?
Definitely, yes.
Which numbers were we working with as of, say, yesterday?
Definitely, because of the fluctuating nature of the number of vehicles on the road, It is always between 50 and 55, because sometimes one is repaired, another breaks down, and vice versa.
So 55 ambulances?
Absolutely.
Not 500?
Not 500.
The whole country?
Absolutely. So basically, let's put the discussions in perspective so that we'll definitely explain the whole concept of EMS, what we call the emergency medical services. Mm-hmm. Once we explain that concept and people really understand how the system works, we'll really also appreciate where the challenges are and what has been done so far.
Okay.
Now, anytime you hear the term ambulance service, you know, abroad they use EMS, which is emergency medical service system. And the reason why people prefer the EMS as against the ambulance service is that, you know, the whole concept of pre-hospital emergency care services really has really been able to transform an evolution to the point where now it's not just ordinary movement of a vehicle, but it is a whole concept of out-of-hospital emergency care services. Mm-hmm. And so now I'll explain the concept and you really see why Ghana chose one particular system against the other.
Okay.
You know, internationally, we have two systems of pre-hospital care or EMS. Mm-hmm. We have what we call the Anglo-American system and then the Franco-German system. Mm-hmm. The Franco-German system practiced in Europe normally is provided by what we call the doctors, the nurses. Then the Anglo-American system is practiced in the UK and then the US and many other countries. And that's when they use paramedics as pre-hospital care providers. Now, the Anglo-American system is based on a concept of the golden hour rule, where it is assumed that in trauma, the best chances of survival is to get the patient into a hospital facility within 1 hour. And so they have a concept they call the scoop and run.
Okay.
Now, the Franco-German system is a concept where they call a stand and play. So you have the whole system of taking the emergency department into the field. They've done research and they've seen that none of the two systems is superior over the other. So it doesn't really matter why you practice one or the other. The reason Ghana chose the Anglo-American system is that,
So the Anglo-American system that we chose is what? Treat on site or pick and run?
It's pick and run. Okay. The scoop and run. Mm-hmm. And that's when you use paramedics for that, because the best chances of survival, especially in trauma, is when you get the person to the hospital and they're able to get the person into a theater environment, operating room within an hour.
Okay.
So the chances of survival definitely are much, much higher. The other reason you choose the Anglo-American system is that it's much easier to train paramedics to get them onto the field to provide out-of-hospital emergency care than getting the few doctors who are not many even in our hospitals into the field. So obviously it makes sense to run the Anglo-American system.
Mm-hmm.
Now, once that system is established, the question is, what are the components of it? First of all, you should have a dispatch system, what we call the control room.
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, you have emergency medical dispatchers. They work in the command center, some may choose to call it. you should also have a unitary toll-free emergency number where people can dial and be able to get direct access to the dispatchers. Once that system also is established, you should have another system which will allow you to be able to dispatch and get access to the operators, like the operational people. And in that regard, you are also able to get people to dispatch into the field. As far as system building is concerned, and the systems are concerned, Ghana, we really have been able to establish the system. The difference with the advanced jurisdictions is the level of sophistication. And in the past, the major difference was in the dispatch system, where they use a lot of technology because their systems were digitized and computerized. Fortunately, with the introduction of this system that President launched today, we have definitely been able to also raise the face of EMS in Africa, and for that matter, the world, because that is the only place where we were lagging behind. So that system has already been established now. The other area where we were having serious challenges definitely was in the area of inadequate fleet of ambulances. And now with the launch of this 307, that also is going to boost tremendously the number of vehicles that we have to dispatch at any point in time.
Okay, so this is like, is it the biggest fleet you've ever had?
Oh, yes. And to be honest with you, sometimes we may be wrong, but so far, our research really shows that in the whole of Africa, this is the biggest fleet any government has procured at any point in time.
Until today, what was the highest we had?
200 by Egypt.
Egypt, which year? In Ghana, I'm referring to Ghana.
Oh, no, for Ghana, the highest we have got was the 161 that were procured in 2012. You know, otherwise, it was 50 at one point. That was 2005. Then 161 in 2012. Then the 30 that came and we had challenges, followed by this 307.
So how come we have only 50 to 55 working ambulances?
Okay, you know, for emergency vehicles, this is how the system works. Because they run 24/7, normally, and by international standards, your plan should be that at every 5 years, you're supposed to replace them because the engines will begin to get weaker.
Okay.
And then they begin to get a lot of breakdown. And then they will spend more time in workshops. Mm-hmm. So you don't want a situation where you'll be traveling with a patient, an emergency, and the vehicle breaks down. So what they normally do is that you normally have a threshold, and you also have certain benchmarks. And the standard is that once the vehicle starts having certain challenges, you're supposed to decommission them and then use them for lesser programs. But for the real emergency care, you should be able to use vehicles that are fit. And so right from 2012 till now, the vehicles have been in existence for some time now. And so what happens is that it might not necessarily be the same number that will be on the road. Let's assume that your station ambulance is working today.
Mm-hmm.
Mine is down. So tomorrow, yours that was working is now down, and mine that was down is now working. I hope you get the point.
Yes, I do.
So basically, if you look at that, that translates into why at every point in time, you have this number of vehicles that are not working.
So this new introduction takes us to over 350 ambulances.
Absolutely.
For the country.
Absolutely.
What is the best ratio, international best ratio?
Yes, so normally you will want that for every 25,000 people, they should have access to one ambulance. Currently, if you look at the population that we have with the 55, it means you are dealing with over 500,000 people per ambulance.
Mm-hmm.
Now, with this introduction of an injection of this 307, you've been able to reduce it from 500,000 to about 80,000.
80,000?
Absolutely.
And we are targeting 25,000.
Absolutely. So you see that absolutely we're doing very well as far as trying to bring down the numbers are concerned.
97.3 CTFM is a station. This is Point Blank. It's some 14 minutes to 1900 GMT. The show is Point Blank. My name is Umaru Sanda Amadu. My guest is the CEO of the Ambulance Service, Professor Zakariah. We're having a conversation around the management of the ambulances, and that's going to be my next question. So assure us that all of them have been dispatched from the Black Star Square. Everything that needs to be fitted has been fitted.
Yeah, I was just there when I had to leave them and come.
Okay.
Like, yeah. So they are on. They are living in batches depending on where they go in.
These ambulances are a campaign promise. They were supposed to be delivered to constituencies. Constituencies are run by who? MPs or party chairmen, not necessarily district assemblies. So each ambulance, so for instance, the Binduri constituency ambulance will be going to Binduri. How do you, Professor Zakaria, manage an ambulance that has been taken to a constituency?
Very good. If you heard the patient, the president, right, mm-hmm. he mentioned that all these ambulances are going to be manned by the National Ambulance Service.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very good call, because our worst nightmare would have been if the vehicles had been released to the politicians. That would have created problems. Because you see, when you are building a system, you try to build a system which is sustainable, number one, and a system that is also devoid of any interference.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're trying to professionally establish a system that can serve the whole community and not individuals. Now, the advantage about placing these ambulances under the care of the National Ambulance Service is this. We're going to establish ambulance stations within the community. The advantage about establishing the ambulance station is that it serves both the community and the health facility. So, for example, if you're in the community and you have an emergency, it's a matter of just getting access and then they'll come and attend to you. Number two, if you were in a health facility and you needed to be transferred to another health facility, obviously the system is there to take care.
Mm-hmm.
The other added advantage is this. Binduri, like you use as a scenario,
mm-hmm.
if Binduri vehicle for some reason was not working or it had gone for servicing, obviously they cannot be left without an ambulance till it returns.
Okay.
So obviously cover will have to be provided by the network of facilities
available.
That are available.
Okay.
And that's the advantage that we have when you try to put them in a system,
mm-hmm.
rather than isolating them and making them.
How do you have your structure? So you are the boss of the ambulance service.
Sure.
Do you have regional director?
We have a three-tier system.
Mm-hmm.
We have the national level, we have the regional level, and we have the district level. And okay. let me explain the different
mm-hmm.
Systems. At a national level, that's where the policy are made.
Mm-hmm.
Policies are made. And therefore, we try to, as part of best practices, try to see what can be replicated in Ghana without having to reinvent the wheel,
mm-hmm.
because EMS is not new.
Mm-hmm.
It's been practiced elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So we just try to copy what is working and what is feasible in our country. If you move from there, you have the regional level where you have the regional medical directors.
Mm-hmm.
They are supposed to provide medical direction for the various regions.
Okay.
You also have regional administrators who are advanced emergency medical technicians. They complement the regional medical directors.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously at that level, they are in charge of the region. So we kind of try to decentralize the system.
Okay.
So unless something is beyond them,
mm-hmm.
all the issues at the region will be addressed by them.
Okay.
Then you move to the lower level, which is the district level or the ambulance stations level.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the operations are carried out. And that is where you have the paramedics stationed there. And then they try to provide cover in crews.
Okay. At the Tatale constituency, for instance, there's an ambulance that would be sent there. Who is in charge of that ambulance? Is it the Tatale MPP constituency chairman or the Tatale MP, if he's an MPP MP, or your man who is at the local level?
Oh, definitely the system is going to be manned by the ambulance
service.
Yeah,
but we know how politicians usually turn the systems on their head. What's the guarantee that this will not happen?
I think if people heard President right, you know, President spoke and he was very emphatic
mm-hmm.
that the ambulances are going to be handed over to the National Ambulance Service.
Mm-hmm.
All day. The constituency is just to identify that, look, this vehicle is going to this constituency.
Okay.
And even for purposes of the tracking,
mm-hmm.
it's easy to know where each vehicle is. The Minister of Health was also very emphatic.
Mm-hmm.
And he also did mention without equivocation that the ambulance service was going to be in charge. The politicians really understand that they rather will even benefit from this arrangement
mm-hmm.
than if they just took the vehicle on their own.
Manage themselves.
Because some of them, when they were asked, especially some of them, when they had interest to send drivers to be trained, they had the erroneous impression that those drivers were the ones who were going to drive the ambulances back to their constituency.
Mm-hmm.
Let me take advantage of this, your platform, and educate them. It's a whole system. And the reality is that one person cannot man an ambulance station. And the other thing is that these are emergency vehicles, and it's a specialty on its own.
Mm-hmm.
So ordinary driving is different from emergency vehicle driving.
Mm-hmm.
Apart from that, these are just not ordinary drivers. We call them emergency medical technician drivers.
Okay.
So they all go through the same training the paramedics will go,
mm-hmm.
apart from the fact that they also benefit from defensive driving training.
In addition,
mm-hmm. obviously. So all these people, when they are trained, they will come and augment the staff strength.
Okay.
And the other reason why it's important to collaborate is mm-hmm. that there will be many instances where that individual ambulance for the constituency might not even be enough,
mm-hmm.
and you need to call for support and backup from adjacent constituencies,
okay.
especially in situations of mass casualty incidents or disasters.
Okay, cool. Now, where are these ambulances going to be stationed? You do not have the stations ready, do you?
We have some stations ready, mm-hmm. and for all the old 130 ambulance stations, they are ready.
Okay.
Out of the new 145, about 80 of them are ready.
Mm-hmm.
So with those two categories of situations, we don't have problems. The problems that we are handling, which obviously are not insurmountable, is the situation where you have the new constituencies
mm-hmm.
that are not ready. They are a bit behind, and they are also working to be able to make sure that they get infrastructure ready.
So in the interim, where do you park the ambulance?
So there will always be two arrangements. If an existing ambulance station is adjacent or nearby, it will operate from there.
Okay.
If we have a fire station
okay.
within the constituency, it will operate from there.
Okay.
If we have a hospital within the constituency, it will operate from there.
Okay.
So obviously, we're going to use...
So it will not be at a party office or someone's home?
Definitely not. And it's not even advisable to do that.
Fantastic. Who is going to fuel all these ambulances?
Obviously, as part of the package, to ensure that this system doesn't become a white elephant,
mm-hmm.
what has been put in place is a support mechanism through the Ministry of Special Development Initiatives and the Ministry of Finance to ensure that adequate funding is made available
okay.
to provide emergency care.
So no one is supposed to pay for ordering an ambulance?
For emergencies, and let me just redefine mm-hmm. that. For emergencies, no one is supposed to order and pay for an ambulance. But for non-emergencies, obviously, there will be a tariff system that will have to be...
So you fuel your ambulances and you fix them? So the maintenance is also in your care?
Absolutely.
And you do this with the support of the government?
Absolutely.
I see. Now, I've seen that you have a new number embossed on the vehicle.
112.
Why that?
Yeah, let me explain. You know, in the past, we had 191 for the police,
mm-hmm.
192 for the fire service, and 193 for the ambulance service.
Mm-hmm.
It can be very confusing in emergencies. And the best practice internationally is to have a unitary system where you don't need to struggle and be remembering different toll-free emergency numbers. And so as part of the best practices, it was found prudent to change all these emergency numbers to 112.
Okay.
So it's just enough to chew only one emergency number, which is the 112.
How did we arrive at this number? And I asked the Minister for Information earlier, but he said the technical people should be the best people. I don't know if you were briefed on how this number was
Let me explain how. You know, there are always international best practices, like we do say.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do your search, 112 is more universal than many of the other numbers. And so when you use 112, that is one of the universally accepted number.
Really?
Exactly.
So many other countries
use 112. So that it becomes much easier to stick to.
I see. 97.3 CTFM. Talk to us about this GPS thing that mm-hmm. you have added to the software. So how is it supposed to work?
Okay. So now, if you start first with the 112,
mm-hmm.
you realize that you have two levels. Either dialing directly on your phone
mm-hmm.
or using the Ghana Post APS, GPS app.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's the Ghana Post 112 you use, you dial and automatically it will get you to the command center.
Mm-hmm.
The command center will then interrogate you and then connect you to the type of emergency that you may have. And obviously, if you have the Ghana Post system, Ghana Post app, GPS app, what is going to happen is that as soon as you click that button, it will definitely and automatically generate the digital address system, which will be automatically sent to the call takers, and your address is actually captured. And when the ambulance is dispatched, automatically it knows where the location will be.
This 112, do you remember how it came to be? Because Ghana is a very political country. When did it start? When did we start thinking of 112?
Oh, not now. The 112 has been in existence. It's just that it was not really operationalized. Mm-hmm. It's been there for some time now. So it's just that many people really did not know about it. You understand? And it was used alongside the other emergency numbers. And because that system existed together with the old system, people really didn't take them serious. But now that we are migrating, that's why it becomes very important.
Let's talk about the facilities that you'll be using. So it's one thing having an ambulance, but it's another thing having the route for your ambulance. I'm sure the EMS would come with, you know, specialized roads for these emergency vehicles. We do not have these, do we?
Obviously.
So if you have a vehicle, and let me just use this sparingly. So I traveled from Gushau to Nalerugu. The road is not good. You have an ambulance that you have put there, and you have to carry it to the Nalerugu Government Hospital. That vehicle definitely break down. So how is that going to affect your operations?
Yeah. So, you know, obviously, you will always take a problem, solve it, and move and take another. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes, depending on the scarcity of resources, you cannot solve all your problems at a go. Mm-hmm. There's something they call the Rural Emergency Medical Service System, known as REMS. Mm-hmm. With the Rural Emergency Medical Service System, what they do is that they try to use tricycles, the robust vehicles, anything that is reachable. And mind you, we have different levels of ambulance system. Mm-hmm. And let me explain the different levels. And you see that as a country, we've achieved one level and we need to start thinking of how to get to the next level. Mm-hmm. You know, you have what we call the boat ambulance system. You use that in places where you are, places that are considered hard to reach areas, like where you have the rivers. So that system definitely will at some point be introduced. Okay. You have even some places where you can even have donkey ambulances, where you are able to get this animals to get you across.
So it doesn't have to be a bus.
It doesn't need to be a bus. I'm just explaining the system. So then you come to the van system, which we have now. The other level, which we have to start thinking of as a country, is the air ambulance system.
Okay.
The reason is this: once you start running a domestic airline, air ambulance system is mandatory internationally.
Okay.
The reason is simple, because imagine all these flights moving across the country. God forbid. Supposing there was an accident far away from the cities. Obviously, the best way of ambulance system will be air evacuation. But currently, we are complacent because we have the Air Force. But remember, the Air Force, they are not air ambulances. They are just helicopters.
Their craft itself just landed in trouble.
Absolutely. So with that situation, for example, we were lucky it was in town. Supposing it was outside town and you had casualties, you needed to have an air ambulance system to do the air evacuation.
We need to go, but let me just bring this. Sanda, can you ask Professor how many of the 275 constituency ambulances are on the road? Because he said 130 of them are ready.
Maybe they didn't understand.
Okay.
All of them are ready.
All have been dispatched.
All have been dispatched.
What happens to the outstanding? So 275 out of 307. My math is not good, but that's like some 30 buses that we still have. What has been happening to them?
So you know that we have already existing ambulance stations, which are not necessarily by constituency name. So obviously those will be part of
them.
Exactly.
But do you have a plan on who is going to get what?
Absolutely, we know. And then you know now, across our major highways, we are what we call the first aid post.
Yes.
And definitely some of these ambulances are going to provide cover.
Would you be giving priority to some rural areas and say, okay, this whole locality, they have only one, they've never had one. So if you're sending just one, why not make it?
And that's why if you check, there are some constituencies that obviously have more than one ambulance.
Okay.
And that's why all the 307 definitely are going to be distributed.
What next? When soon should we expect more ambulances? Have you been told anything? Is it going to be an annual affair or is it a four-year affair?
This is just the beginning. Obviously, we are very optimistic as we are always. And we see a lot of light at the end of the tunnel.
Okay. Professor Ahmed Zuhu Zakariah, CEO of the National Ambulance Service, thank you for coming on Point Blank.
Thank you for having me.